Good evening, everybody. Today is Monday, July 23rd. It is 7 p.m. and we are opening the Keller Independent School Board of Trustees meeting. And we're going to start with, we don't have an executive session this evening, so we're going to start with the Pledge of Allegiance. If I can stand up.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Let me get situated here. All right, the next thing on our agenda are awards, achievements, and recognitions.
Good evening. In your board packet, you will find student and staff achievements on pages 5 and 6. We will take photos of award recipients immediately following the awards portion of the agenda. For our first award tonight, I would like to invite Board Member Chris Roof to please come forward. Our Hard at Work recipient for May is a Sunset Valley Elementary Co-Cur aide. She was nominated by Sunset Valley Elementary Principal Kristen Erickson, who said, "Thank you for all your help during dismissal on that cold, windy, rainy day." Hard to remember weather like that.
I'm so confused.
And she said, "You were ready to get our kids safely loaded into their cars. You are the kind of person who is willing to jump in and help at any time. I know you will make an excellent coach someday. Thank you for being there and for going above and beyond." Ladies and gentlemen, please help me congratulate our Hard at Work recipient, Sunset Valley Elementary Co-Cur aide, Katie Wilson. For our next award, I would like to invite Board Member Jim Stitt to please come forward, along with Assistant Superintendent of Human Resources, Tommy Johnson. And here to present the United Healthcare Well-Deserved Award is United Healthcare Strategic Account Executive, Marty Skinner.
Thank you. You know, when you think of United Healthcare, typically you think about insurance. And while it's true that we are an insurance company, what you may not know is that we also are a health and wellness company. Our mission statement is actually to help people live healthier lives. There is not a customer meeting that we have where we don't talk about the tools and services and help that we have invested in over the years and that we continue to invest in to help your members and their family members make better health decisions. But not all customers listen and accept those suggestions or recommendations, if you will. It is estimated that about 80% of every dollar spent on claim expenses is based on a modifiable health risk. That simply means that if your membership made better health decisions, that they would save money, they would get higher quality of care, and the school district would save money. Fortunately, Keller ISD has listened to those suggestions over the years. For the last 10 years, United Healthcare has recognized those customers who have been listening. And it is with a lot of pride that as a representative of United Healthcare for Keller ISD, Keller has been recognized for the last 3 years as well, winning a wellness award. And for the second consecutive year in a row, they have been recognized as from all of our national companies as winning the top award for the Golden Apple Award. So please welcome Sherry Rich and Janelle Warner from your benefits office and all the work that they have done in implementing these wellness and education programs for your membership.
Good
next award, I would like to invite Board Vice President Karina Davis, Board Member Brad Schofield, and Chief of School Cecil McDaniels to join me. Hidden Lakes Elementary and Indian Springs Middle earned a 2018 Schools Transforming Learning Distinction by the Principals Institute and were recognized at the Institute's Summer Conference in June. The Principals Institute awards the Schools Transforming Learning Distinction to campuses that are making exceptional strides on their journey to provide innovative learning opportunities for all students. Hidden Lakes and Indian Springs are two of only 31 campuses across the state to receive this distinction. Nominations for the honor were open to campuses led by any of the nearly 350 Institute participants or alumni who represent more than 72 public school districts. The Institute is a statewide professional learning series designed to challenge thinking and help campus leaders develop and sustain transformative learning environments. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me congratulate Hidden Lakes Elementary Principal Melanie Graham and Indian Springs Middle School Principal Sandy Trout. At this time, I would like to invite Board Secretary Ruthie Keyes to please come forward, and for this next recognition, I'll turn it over to Dr. Westfall.
Thank you, Shelley. Shelley's given me a script to make sure that I don't go too off script with this next award for the Communications Department. I have the privilege of working closely with this team for a full year now, and it's been amazing. Even though we've been running 100 miles an hour, they produce quality work in a timely manner every time. So I'm not surprised, but happy to share with you that the district's... Why are you laughing? I'm just reading the words that you wrote. Happy to share with you that the district's communication team returned in February from its Texas School Public Relations Association annual conference with 12 star awards, which provide recognition for outstanding education communication projects throughout the state. Entries were produced during the 2016-2017 school year, and our communications team was recognized with 5 golds, 6 silvers, and 1 bronze on several pieces, including videos, prezzies, print pieces, and social media campaigns. In addition, the Keller ISD video portfolio was awarded a Certificate of Merit in the Crystal Commendation, while the Campus Teachers of the Year video won Best of Category. Please help me congratulate Shelley Johnson, Matt Hill, Bryce Neiman, Nicole Lyons, Nicole McCullum, Morgan Mizell, and Deneen Russler.
Shelley, back to work. Let's go.
Thank you for that heartfelt
support. Just want to note that it was February that they received these awards, and they just now got it on the agenda because they had so many more important things to get on there and did not want to recognize
themselves.
Every
word you spoke.
Mm-hmm, I did. I felt it.
I felt it, too. And for our final award this evening, I would like to invite Board Member Beverly Dixon and Chief of School Cecil McDaniel, please come forward. This past March, Central High School adult transition teachers Chelsea Brockmuller and Jody Smith helped save the life of a student choking on a piece of pizza who had fallen to the ground and was actually turning blue. Unable to lift the student in order to perform the Heimlich, Chelsea immediately turned the student to the side and began patting the student's back until the food was dislodged. During that time, Jody jumped into action and called 911. Central High School's nurse and security officer were also quick to the scene, assisting the student to a chair and check vitals. The paramedics arrived shortly after and resumed care. Jody followed them to the hospital until parents arrived. Keller ISD is very thankful for the quick thinking, heroic actions, and caring hearts of these two Central High School teachers. Unfortunately, Jody Smith could not join us this evening, but please help me show our appreciation to Chelsea Brock-Moeller.
Next item on our agenda is audience with individuals, and we had no one sign up this evening, so we're going to move on to the consent agenda. Do I have a motion? Okay, do I have a second? All right. All those in favor of the consent agenda? All right, 7-0. Thank you. It was Karina and Jim.
Jim, and then I second.
And she second. Sorry. All right, the next item on our agenda are our action items. Action item 8A is the adoption of the resolution to consider alternative graduation requirements.
One action item and everybody left. Come on, guys. They're laughing, I hear them.
Missing some good stuff, guys.
This really is good stuff. On page 67, you'll see your only action item this evening on a resolution to consider alternative graduation requirements. This really is an exciting one. During the last legislative session, we finally got a chance to find a pathway for students to graduate who had failed tax exams beginning back in 2011. It's been almost a decade that we've had students coming back to take tax tests over and over and over again for a very long time. The administrative code was revised just a few weeks ago to give us that grace. So we're coming with you tonight with this resolution that would approve a local alternative requirement to allow a district-wide committee to make a decision on whether or not these former students, adults, may get a diploma. We recommend that you do pass the resolution with these local credits, and if you do so, we'll be graduating just over a dozen of them at the summer graduation this year. And with that, the administration recommends that you approve the resolution as presented.
All right, do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All right. Any questions for Amanda?
I had a quick question. There's a September 2019 date in there. Is that like an expiration for this?
The statute expires in September of 2019, so if we're going to have students graduate, we have to do it within the next year or so. We think we've swept them all at this point, and we'll get them at this graduation ceremony, but we will have a little bit of time if we've missed any.
Okay, and then after that date, it kind of, the door shuts kind of deal.
The door shuts unless the legislature re-ups it, but it'll sunset on September 2019, so the resolution will as well.
Okay, thank you.
Do you feel pretty confident you found everyone?
Good question. We certainly have found the ones that kept retaking.
Okay.
We've had one sweet young lady who's taken it every single time she can, and she has spurred us to quick action with this.
Good for her.
Just because we admire her tenacity.
Yep. Any other questions? All right, all those in favor? All right, thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Let's move on to reports. The first one is the summer hiring update.
Tommy's going to come forward with a brief update about summer hiring and an introduction, I think, right?
Sure. You do have on pages 72 through 74, the list gets longer as we move through the summer, of your board book, the individuals, as well as we put an addendum at your seat tonight. Each of those folks has been recommended for contractual employment with Keller ISD for the 18-19 school year. But most importantly tonight, we have a formal introduction of one of our new campus leaders, and I will ask Ms. Simmons to please come to the microphone.
Thank you, Mrs. Johnson. I'd like to just take a moment, if you don't mind, to introduce a couple of my family members that are here, my husband, Mike, and my daughter, Kelly. wanted to thank them for their support, and I'm very grateful to have them alongside of me with this journey. As you know, being a secondary leader, it involves a lot of your time and energies, and I've always had their full support, so I'm very grateful for that. Just want to take a moment and say I am truly humbled and honored to lead Keller High School. I am so proud of the successes of our students and look forward to their continued successes as we move into the future. I want to thank you all for your support as a school board, as you supported Keller ISD and specifically Keller High School. Please know that I am grateful for each one of you and would love to see you at our campus anytime, so please drop by and visit. Thank you.
That's it. All right. The next report will be Durham Transportation.
Thank you for allowing us to be here. My name is Tony Bartlett. I'm the Senior Vice President for the South Central area. We are very, very proud to be partnered with the Keller ISD. With me tonight is Debbie Cardell. She is our Regional Manager, Debbie, and Brad Kerrigan, who is our new General Manager. So, Brad, a little bit about our backgrounds. We're all from retail. Okay, and you might ask yourself, well, what does retail have to do with this? You know what? We're used to managing large chunks of people and motivating and driving results. I myself was an executive vice president for JCPenney. Debbie was a regional vice president for JCPenney in her last assignment, and Brad Kerrigan is a retail professional. He's run stores for many different companies. So, a little bit about Durham, and I promise I won't go long here, but we've been around for about 101 years. We transport about 1 million students every day, and we have more than 20,000 employees, and we partner with over 400 school districts. This is our core values. I'm not gonna go through all this, but I think a couple of them bear a little conversation. One is safety. That is the most important thing that we do, is making sure that the children of this district and every other district arrive where they're going to school and back home safely every day. We spend a tremendous amount of time training our employees and screening to make sure that we've got great people. And the other piece that I would talk about is customers. You're our customer, the administration is our customer, the parents and the children are our customers. We want to be very responsive to all of you. If there are ever concerns or things that we can do to help, we want to make sure that we're there for you. So we work for you. You're the Keller ISD. We have Brad again, and currently our operations supervisor is open. We're sourcing someone right now. Carla Alvarez. Carla, please stand up, is our training, our safety and training supervisor. Mike Robinson, our maintenance supervisors, and we have dispatchers, routers, safety, and all kinds of support folks to make sure that we get the job done right. I'm really, really proud of the job that Debbie and her team in a very short time have done, so I'm gonna let her share what we did in 2017, 2018, but more importantly, talk about the great things that we're gonna do for you in 2018 and 2019. Debbie?
Thank you. Tony got to cover all the fluff and I get all the meat, so nice job, Tony. The first thing I want to talk about is what we've done for as far as our bus safety commitment. Last year in June of 2017, we hired an external company to come in and certify all of our buses from a safety standpoint. Any bus that didn't pass the first certification would go back for repairs and then come back through and be recertified again until it met that proper certification and was road ready and safe and ready to hit the ground running. We then, based on your suggestion and input, we did that again in Christmas, over Christmas vacation, and we recertified the buses all again throughout Christmas break. We are committed to continue this service going forward, and I'll talk a little bit about at the end of the presentation on what we're going to do to make sure we are, again, road ready for school startup. Couple things we've done with maintenance. We upgraded the existing team that we have in place through either training or we've hired some people and maybe swapped out a couple people. We've also upped the number of technicians or mechanics, as you may know them better, on our team. So we ended the school last year with four. It kind of went back and forth between four and five. We ended up with four. We currently have six mechanics on board. We will have eight here shortly. I think we've got one who is just about ready to get started and another one who is very close. So we will have eight mechanics throughout the school year. Everything we've done so far, though, has already made a huge impact. This CSD was struggling with our compliance, that's a preventative maintenance compliance. I'm proud to say in the last 8 weeks, we've been at a 98% compliance, which is above what the company averages. So we're really pleased with the progress we're making. The next piece talks a little bit about our driver oversight, which, we're committed to having our students' safety in first and foremost in our minds. One thing that we have installed in all of our Keller buses is it's a camera called Drive Cam. It actually looks like this, and this is mounted on the windshield. It gives a front view and a back view, so a view out to the road and a view of the driver. And what happens is anything that is out of the ordinary, an occurrence out of the ordinary from a driver's standpoint, either they slam on their brakes, they make a quick swerve, it triggers the Drive Cam, then that immediately is uploaded to our CSC. Either Brad or Carla get that information, the driver comes back, we sit down with that driver and have a conversation about why did this happen, how could it have been prevented. So if it offers a great coaching tool to those bus drivers. And obviously we are going to track bus drivers who have a consistent record of opportunities, and they will no longer drive for us if it's an ongoing opportunity. A little bit down on the page, we talked about the strict enforcement of zero tolerance. We've had that program for some time, but we really have, in the last 12 months, gone full court press on enforcing this zero tolerance program. This is zero cell phone tolerance. If you're caught using the phone anywhere on the bus yard or anywhere driving the bus whatsoever, the driver is immediately terminated. We've terminated 130 drivers as a company, which is a small percentage, about 1% of our drivers. We've terminated two at our Keller location. So we are absolutely enforcing the zero tolerance program. Something that we're really excited about, and obviously attracting and retaining talent is a huge opportunity everywhere, but it's really challenging from a bus driver standpoint, because I don't know if you all drive up and down the 35, but there are billboards everywhere advertising for we need drivers, we need drivers. So we've upped the ante. We have raised the bus driver wage to $3 an hour for everyone at the Keller facility. The entire rate is up to $18 an hour. No matter how many hours you work during the day, you are guaranteed to be paid for 5 hours. So if you work 0 hours, you're paid for 5 hours, which is a huge advantage to the bus drivers at the Keller location. We also offer some bonuses, a $2,000 bonus, hire-on bonus for non-CDL drivers, a $3,000 bonus for fully certified CDL drivers. This has cost Durham, the Keller facility, $375,000. None of this budget is coming out of the Keller ISD. We are absorbing, 100% absorbing that cost, so we can offer you a phenomenal school year. This is just a recap of all the driver training that we offer when we hire a new driver, and you can see it's an extensive, and that's what Carla is in charge of. She's in charge of getting our drivers on board and getting them trained, and you can see that's an extensive amount of training. These are our hire requirements. The only thing I want to touch on here is that we just know that we do a full background check on every driver, and that goes back 10 years, no felonies, no DUIs for the past 10 years. We do drug testing, we do random drug testing and alcohol testing throughout the year, and ongoing training as needed. The last bullet there, Samba Safety, I did want to touch on that briefly. That's a new program that our company is rolling out, and this is a real-time driving record report that every facility will get on their drivers or anybody working for them. So for example, if I left here tonight and I got a ticket for speeding, Tony would know about it next week that I got a ticket for speeding. And I don't know, Tony, nothing? All right, so it's a real-time reporting, so we'll know right up front when a driver gets a ticket for any kind of driving violation. All of our buses are loaded with Zonar GPS. And this is for us to be able to keep track of all of our buses, where they are, if they're on time, and how their route is going. It also offers, from a safety standpoint, a pre-trip and a post-trip check so that we make sure our buses are ready to hit the road. And if they come back and they have a post-trip opportunity, we can get that into the maintenance team right away and make sure the bus is ready to run first thing the next morning. This is a report called the bus report. And Mark, I owe you some information on getting this on the website to get the link for our parents. But this is a report that any of you can use in this room. Our parents can use. They can go in and offer any compliments or any opportunities that they may find with Durham in the Keller location. And we will respond back to them in a 24-hour timeline, depending on the severity of what the opportunity may be. So Mark will get that posted on the Keller ISD website and how the parents can get through that portal. Let's see. The last thing I want to touch on, so that's the past. That's everything we did for you last year. And we have some things that we're going to commit to going forward in 2018 and 2019. Staffing is huge. As you all know, we talked a lot about the driver staffing and getting and bringing them on board and retaining them. Our goal is to be staffed at 120%. What that means is 20% over goal. For Keller, we have 149 routes. So that means we want to have 180 bus drivers. And we are well on track to make that target easily by school startup. And hopefully some additional cushion after that. Because when you get sick calls or something goes wrong with the driver and they can't come in, we want to be able to have a driver ready to go when that first thing in the morning so we aren't late for a route. We've hired two additional dispatchers, and those are going to be, we've already got one on board. And this is important because we ran with like 1.5 last year, and it was a little tight getting all the bus drivers out of the parking lot with their keys in hand and ready to go. We will have 3 dispatchers doing that this year, so we're really excited about that. We've added additional trainers and recruiters to make sure we maintain this level of 120% going forward. And the last thing on this page is about a month ago, I think Carla and I rolled out to all of our existing drivers a $2,500 retention bonus. So we're gonna offer this in installments. So they'll get the last chunk of that after Christmas. So we ensure they come back after holiday. And it's a pretty good deal. And this is another about $375,000 that we are absorbing as a company. Because we just want to make sure that we're ready for the back half of the school year. So we're pretty excited about that one, as are our drivers. It was very well received. Going on the bus safety and maintenance piece, we are in the process now of making sure we are 100% inspecting all of our buses and that they are, again, ready to start for startup. We went through about 80 buses last week. We're going through about another chunk this week. We are also going to do, we did the external certification last summer and at holiday. We are going to do an internal certification. And by internal, I don't mean the employees of the Keller facility. This is a company-wide group that we bring in to go in and certify every bus. So on top of us looking at it, we'll have another set of eyes come back through and look at every bus and make sure they are road safe and ready for startup. We're testing every radio and camera. I know it sounds silly, but we are washing every single bus in the month of July, so they will get a hand wash, so they look great when we start up. And in some cases, we've actually painted the entire bus. We've waxed the entire bus. We've waxed some of the parts of the buses, but we want to make sure that not only do they run well, but they look great when they start for startup. Last slide I want to talk about is our actual startup. And we are actually bringing our drivers back 7 days early this year. We generally only bring them back 2 days prior to the school startup, but we're bringing them back 7 days early. This is a great benefit to them. They get a whole extra week of pay, which is fantastic for them. And we are going to utilize that time to offer some additional training as needed for some safety training and some operational training. We're going to do 2 days. We're going to do a dry run twice on the actual drive time so that it's in the morning and the afternoon. Obviously, we can't do it. Traffic's going to be busier on the first day of school, so it'll be a little different the first day of school, but we'll do it during the actual school bus route time, which makes a huge difference. And each bus driver, we're going to allow them to personalize their bus. It sounds kind of silly, but we did this at Capel, and it worked exceptionally well. A lot of the younger children they'll forget a bus number very quickly, and will head out to their bus and go have that panic moment. They don't know what their bus is. So we're going to allow the bus driver to whatever their favorite character may be or animal they'll personalize their bus with that character so the kids will know I was on the giraffe bus today or I was on the Mickey Mouse bus today. So when they go out, they'll be able to find their bus a lot easier, just something fun for the bus drivers to do that week as well. So I hope that you see from what Tony and I have covered, we're very, very committed to offering you, our parents, our children, the administration, a great startup and a great year for 2018 and 2019. And ultimately, we'll on the September 8th election, we'll get the vote going the right direction for you. So I think, Tony, that's it? Oh, sure, that's August 4th, and we actually decided that after we put the deck together. We're, I think it's at the, which high school is it at, Carla? Trinity Middle School? The one right across from the CSC location. It's in the morning, I believe it's from 8 to 1, and every parent can bring their child out and actually meet their bus driver that morning. So it's kind of an open house from 8 to 1 that day. That was actually bubbled up through a bus driver, and we thought it was a great idea. So we're going to serve hot dogs and popcorn machines and drinks and all sorts of fun stuff so they can bring their child out to meet the bus driver. Thanks for reminding me, Mark.
Okay. Any other questions?
I have one.
Okay.
I appreciate all this.
Sure.
One question I have, though, when y'all came on board, we talked about clean fuel on the buses, and you guys said that you would be adding those buses that had the that were using the natural gas.
Talking about propane?
Yes. And so how many of those have we added?
You have propane buses? I don't know. Brett said we have 12 right now.
Okay, but we started with what? And then, because we were told that we that you would be adding buses each year to that, and I don't know that they have been added each year.
Yeah, honestly, I don't know either. Debbie and I are relatively new, but that's something we can go back and follow up on. If we made that commitment to you, we'll go back and see what we can,
okay.
can make happen
thank you.
With it.
Thanks. All right, thank you.
Day six, I think, today. Day six for Brad.
Okay.
Okay. Anybody else?
Thank you.
I assume it's part of your washing and checking the buses and all that, and I know summer gets a little crazy, but one thing I've noticed kind of out running around town in the middle of the day is that a number of the buses that I've had the luxury of being behind in traffic is that we have an awful lot of the stickers that are either so faded or completely unreadable. Things like the I Stop for Railroad Tracks. I was behind one the other day and I should have gotten the bus number. But it was, it had a empty sign on the back window and there was obviously people on the bus. And then all of the bumper stickers on the bus were not readable. So I couldn't even tell you what they were supposed to say. By placement, I can tell you what I would have assumed they were, but they weren't at all readable.
Okay.
So hopefully it's just one or two, but certainly
we'll check
something
them out. I mean, that's good feedback. That'll be part of what we do when we have them inspected to make sure that they have everything that they're supposed to have and that it all looks good.
Oh, the no turn on red, I think, is the other one that's usually there.
That's a good memory.
Yeah, it's good.
Okay. Jim?
Go ahead, Jim.
I have two. One, when you mentioned you would know about a ticket right away, I'm thinking, wait a second, aren't we innocent until proven guilty? Is that when the ticket's written or when the judge says?
It'll be once that becomes a part of the driver's record, then the Samba system will push out those notices to our manager. So once that becomes part of the driver's record, that's when that'll happen.
Once they're convicted of that violation. Okay. Our coaches drive your buses. What's the relationship there between their qualifications or responsibilities as far as your equipment is concerned?
They have to have the same safety requirements, the same qualifications, same training that anybody else that drives the bus. If a coach drives a bus, they have to have that same thing.
Do you provide some type of feedback to the athletic director if a bus is not returned in good order?
I don't know that that's ever happened. I mean, I'm sure that it probably has. I'm not aware of it, but
I think we probably have pretty good communication.
But the main thing is we want the children to be safe,
right,
no matter who drives the bus. So they'll get the same exact thing.
Well, your part is maintaining the equipment and giving them a bus that is basically sound, but I want them to return that in the same fashion.
We do as well.
Okay.
Okay.
Good. Thank you.
Brad?
Following up on the propane thing, just to get in my mind to understand a little better, is it about the same, cheaper, or less expensive to run a propane bus compared to a gasoline bus, or?
I believe it's slightly more expensive, but I'm not going to sit here and claim to be an expert. I'm going off a memory that I have about a discussion, so I may be wrong, but I believe it's slightly more expensive.
A little more, okay. Okay. You don't know how much.
He said the gas mileage is also, they get a little worse gas mileage than would a diesel bus.
Oh, the propane does?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
Okay. Anybody else?
I have a question.
Okay.
On your reporting system, your bus report, as a parent who's made a couple of calls this past year,
sure.
Have you rolled that out with other school districts?
This is a company-wide. It's a company-wide program.
And you said it's going to be a 24-hour turnaround?
Well, so it's based on the severity of what's inputted in the system. Some of them are a 24-hour turnaround and some are 3 days.
Okay.
Just depending on the severity of what the complaint may be.
Is that clearly outlined on the...
It is for it, well, on the...
Like
on
when
the
if I, as a
website,
parent, I go on, you know, as a parent, I go on to put in a complaint, does it say on there you will receive a response 24 to 72 hours from now?
I don't believe so, but there is a guide that I'm going to send to Mark that's kind of a user's guide that he will post as well, and I do believe it's on there, but I will have to double-check for you for sure.
I mean, I know a couple times, I almost got hit by a bus running a stop sign this year, but I've gotten other complaints from parents saying, well, I tried to get a hold of them to make a complaint, I can't get anything, so.
I would tell you, reason that we're all standing here kind of brand new is because I don't think the company was happy with some of the things that were happening. Debbie has shared with me, she's talked to a couple parents before Brad got here, and the parent says, wow, somebody called me back. We're going to call you back.
Okay,
we're going to call you back. We're going to follow up. But I do want to say with the bus report, I think it's important that we get back to whoever, but I think the more important thing and the reason that we adopted this is a repository for feedback. And we want, and it was difficult if you were to call me or to someone else was to call Brad, and we might not know that we have an issue with the driver. This repository, we can review all of this information. We may have a driver that shouldn't be driving for us, and now we'll be able to know that, and we'll make those adjustments. But you can also rest assured we're gonna get back to you.
Perfect. Thank you.
Okay. Is that it? All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
The next item on our report agenda is safety and security. Kevin.
Good evening. On page 9 of your board packet, you will see the district security report in support of the district's key strategic priorities, excellence in student, parent, and community relations, and employee excellence and operational improvement. I would like to take a brief moment and give you an update on the security department's upgrades that we'll be implementing in the upcoming school year. KISD currently has a myriad of security measures in place, and as per Governor Abbott's proposed agenda, in response to continued school violence, KISD has discussed additional security measures. To enhance the existing safety and security infrastructure, KISD will be implementing the following security measures. We have begun installing reflective door numbering on all our campuses. The purpose is to provide a faster way to give a location in an emergency. This allows staff and students the ability under stress to give first responders a way to identify the location and respond to the threat quickly. Knowing that time is crucial, the Fort Worth SWAT team conducted their active shooter training under the door numbering system at one of our campuses this summer. This enhanced the officer's ability to quickly respond and locate the threat. The security department will be providing wands and holsters to all secondary campuses. In addition to being cost effective, unlike metal detectors, wands can be used anywhere at any time without limitations. Wands can also provide random screenings of students, much like the canine drug detection dogs. They eliminate the possibility of having students standing outside waiting to gain access to a campus and becoming easier targets for an active shooter. Based on my professional experience, metal detectors can only truly be effective if we place one at every door or assign personnel to watch every door while we process individuals. Along with the SROs assigned to Keller High School and KCAL, KISD will be hiring a mobile Keller SRO specifically assigned to respond to our remaining Keller campuses. This will alleviate the need for officers to leave their assigned locations and respond to surrounding campuses. We have also secured a permanent Fort Worth SRO for Fossil Hill Middle School, and we are requesting a mobile officer also to patrol our secondary campuses at those locations. We'll be adding a trained certified gun detection canine to our random patrols. The certified gun detection canine will be wearing an identifiable vest and has the ability to locate four distinct odors: guns that have been fired, guns that have not been fired, gun cleaning oils, and ammo casings. To the best of our knowledge, we'll be the only district that has a certified gun detection canine specifically assigned to our district for the purposes stated above. We will now have available to us at any time a drug, bomb, and gun detection canine to assist in securing and patrolling our campuses. I have often been asked by parents, what can we do to assist in keeping our kids safe? We have developed a new program that will elicit parents and community volunteers to help patrol our campuses during high volume times. We will be providing campuses with posters and flyers along with information on our websites with directions on how to sign up for the program. Volunteers will be vetted with background checks before being assigned to campuses. They will be provided radios and security vests to identify themselves. They are only there for purposes to observe, report, and be visible. After meeting with the fire marshal regarding a potential threat of an active shooter by pulling a pull station, it was recommended that we institute a fire alarm delay system. This will only require an adjustment to the fire panel, which indicates the location of the pull station that has been activated. We can then determine whether there is a need to evacuate the campus or not. The reason behind this proactive approach is that the latest events have involved active shooters attempting to cause as much harm to as many people as possible by pulling our pull stations. We'll be reprogramming all pull stations with a 30-second delay. This will reduce false alarms and secure students while preventing them from leaving campuses unnecessarily. Also, we will ensure the safety of students from being potential targets of an active shooter. We have purchased emergency strobe lights and will be installing them in high volume areas such as gyms, cafeteria, band halls, and outside areas in the upcoming weeks. The strobe lights will automatically be activated when the telecenter emergency system is deployed. This notification alert will alert faculty and students who are unable to hear emergency announcements. It will also provide an alert notification to outside KISD personnel and any persons approaching the campus to let them know that we are in lockdown.
Hey, Kevin, the slides aren't lining up with your... You're all right.
Back up. Did I miss it? Strobe. Okay.
There we go.
Okay. I'm looking at two different screens here. It's confusing. All right, here we go. We believe that there can never be enough training. That being said, the security officers completed the 5-day state level 2 and 3 security training this summer. This included firearms, self-defense, shotgun, baton, handcuff, and de-escalation tactics. The district security personnel are now trained and certified in level 2 and 3 security. In closing, I'd like to reassure our students and parents and community that the KISD Safety and Security Department will continue to be creative, innovative, and explore new ideas and technology while always adhering to best practices. Thank you. I'll take any questions.
All right. Thank you, Kevin. Any questions for Kevin down here?
Thank you for that presentation, Kevin. I appreciate that. You covered a couple things here. Officers will now be at all secondary campuses?
We'll have a mobile officer that will be able to respond to our secondary campuses on the Keller side. So we have an officer assigned to Keller High School and one assigned to KCAL.
Okay.
Usually if we have an event that's happening at a middle school, one of those officers would have to leave the campus and respond to that.
Okay.
Now we've initiated having a mobile officer now will be available to respond to those additional campuses now and patrol those campuses for us.
Okay. And then the dogs, the bomb, gun, and drug dogs, they are also mobile, I'm assuming they would?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
They would go where needed.
Where needed, they can also be used as a deterrent. Having dogs sit outside with the vest on that says gun detection and be a great deterrent. We can use them as we use the drug dogs. We can search classrooms, whatever we have to do with them.
Would the idea be to split them up?
Yes.
Okay, I would think.
And we also have them if there is a need. If somebody might suspect something in the school, we can always call them and have them come and do the search.
Okay, all right, excellent, thank you.
Thanks for adding the commission officers. I think that's a good move. The other thing is I guess one of the things I wanted to back up and do, the badges. I know we had somebody present that to us, one of the students at one point a few months back. What's your feeling about student badges, ID badges? Don't consider the RFID thing in there, just badge.
We're actually probably this close to getting that done. I didn't want to talk about it because we haven't fully initiated it yet, but we're very close in having that done. We still have code of conduct that we have to get together. But I just got an email today and some good news on some things that we can do. So we're still actively looking at that, and that will be done, I'm sure.
Okay, and then the follow-up on that is, I notice a lot of students will prop a door open at the high school for a friend or something. I didn't know if the badges could be, and it might be too much, be magnetic or something like ours where it opens the door for the student, or is that too much?
Well, that doesn't alleviate the propping of the doors. The propping of the doors is a mental thing for our students and for our staff. I mean, we do it because it's convenient for us.
Right.
It's not a point of whether you badge in or badge out. It's a point of, you know, just changing that mentality that we have to keep our doors closed at all times.
Okay, I guess what I do is, like, when I drop my son off in the morning, you know, see the cheerleading squad come through and they'll prop the door open so the squad can come through. And I didn't know, you know, if they had a magnetic badge, they can leave the door shut and just pop themselves in when they need to. And
but it's not only them. I mean, a lot of people are guilty of that. I think it's just human behavior, and trying to change that probably is the biggest challenge that I have.
Okay, all right.
I just want to say that I really appreciate everything you do. It's when I go to and meet with other schools and everything, especially with North Texas area school boards, we talk about our safety, and I feel like we are far above anybody. And I say that I believe it's because of you and your, you know, determination and your desire to make us the best. I appreciate you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Down here?
Yes, please. I have a couple of questions. Kind of pertaining to what Brad said about the propping of the doors, are you looking at some type of training for the high school students, specifically the high school students, because you just don't see middle schools do it as much,
right,
about, hey, this is how you can help protect?
We actually met with two students today for doing that. They got in some serious trouble for going in the door that was propped, and Dr. Westfall and myself are going to have those students actually come and talk to some of the students about the consequences of doing stuff like that. Once again, like I said, this is the biggest challenge for me, is changing that human behavior and letting kids understand that. And even our staff members. Our staff members are very guilty of that. I mean, we catch them on tape all the time where they're propping a door and they forget to leave to close the door back. So it's just preaching that message over and over and over again.
Okay, and just a point of clarification. our middle schools and intermediates have a security officer on campus, but the SRO is just an additional person, a uniformed police officer that will be coming to help support them in
Absolutely.
The event if something happens.
Absolutely.
So we still have security officers on campus.
Absolutely.
This is just somebody else. And then with your POP program, I think that's a great idea. Are you looking at utilizing them like when you have field day and all the kids are outside, or when they're at KISD at the
We're going to use them as much as we possibly can, as many events as possible. The feedback that we have gotten is that they want to be involved in everything that we do as much as we do, whether it's events, games, basketball games, whatever it is, they want to be there and be visible.
Perfect. I think it's a great idea. Thank you.
Anybody else?
Thank you for all you've done, Kevin. We've come a long way. Thank you.
Just one additional question on the POP program. Are we looking at that kind of across the district or only at middle and high school? What level are you considering that
We're
for?
Focusing first on the secondary campuses, but okay. We're doing it Keller and Fort Worth side.
Perfect, thank you.
Kevin, I just want to echo what Ruthie said, that I feel like it's always a huge point of pride when we, especially when we meet with other school districts, that, you know, they talk about the things they want, and it's like, oh, we have that. Oh, we have that. You know, and we love to also tell people that our security guy used to be a New York cop. Then they really are like, oh, okay, that's great. So, but I just want to thank you, because I know that your expertise has been invaluable to this, and I just appreciate your diligence to just keep at it, and even when you've met with resistance, that you just kept at it, and that we've, you know, I feel like our children are as safe as they can possibly be.
Thank
so
you.
Thank you very much. The next item in our agenda is Keller University, which I hated missing. I was so jealous every day. So.
Very excited to speak with you today. Last week we had our fourth annual Keller University. I just want to give you some highlights of the event.
Will you tell everybody your name?
Yes, it's Jennifer Love, coordinator of professional learning. I had a wonderful team. Let me start off by saying that Valerie Miner's here, Sarah Smith, Christy Harold were not able to be here, Aaron Reister and his genius team, and I want to thank Lindsay Anderson for helping with our vision. So thank you for that. We held Keller University at Timber Creek High School last week, Tuesday through Thursday. We offer 269 courses for our teachers and staff. Everything from leadership, passion, content. We had certification opportunities for them. We had classes on passion, motivation, even health and wellness. It's kind of exciting. Sherry had some interesting how to be well and sleep, I think it was pretty cool. We had a huge turnout for this event, and part of it was due to two world-renowned keynotes in Ron Clark from Ron Clark Academy and John Gordon, a very reputable speaker on positivity and an author. It was wonderful. Each of those keynotes had between 850 to 1,000 participants from our district, so very excited about the turnout for that. We had hundreds of tweets and shout-outs on social media. We were actually trending in the DFW area 2 days running. Very excited about that. Had friends in other districts that were super jealous. It was very nice to hear. Let's move on to participation. These are some shout-outs that we are very, very proud of. We had 1,660 participants. They averaged 6 sessions per person, and the sessions range between an hour and 6 hour classes. That is a 40% growth from last year in participation, and a 53% growth from the year before that. We were able to grant 13,978 hours of equivalency time to our teachers at KISD. And just putting that in perspective, last year, the requirements for our teachers were 6 hours of equivalency time, and our teachers accrued about 25% of that at KU. This year, our equivalency time was 18 hours of required time, and we actually had 46% of our teachers accrue those hours. So you can see that's an enormous amount of growth. Very excited about that. One of our main missions for Keller University was not just to make it a sit and get. We wanted to make this an experience. So the whole experience of Keller University was not just going and sitting in a class and getting information. We had over 50 local sponsors and vendors at our Keller University Mall selling things as well as advertising for their businesses. We had Chick-fil-A and the Daily Grind Cafe there offering food and beverages to our teachers all 3 days. We also had a Google Playground that we're giving many learning sessions on all the new things Google that are coming into our district this year. So they teachers could come in between classes and get information from our spectacular helpers. We also had a presenter lounge. We were able to have comfortable seating. We stocked it with food and beverages. And again, our presenters, are most of the presenters were our district personnel. So it was nice for them, I'm sure, to be treated special at an event. Not only are they a teacher on day to day, but they're actually a presenter. And we wanted to make sure they had a good experience with that. We had 161 volunteer spots that resulted in 322 community service hours that we granted for students of Keller ISD. I'm hugely excited about that. That's a huge excitement for me, that these kids were able to come in, get their community service hours for Green Cord or for any other service organizations, and we were able to provide that for them. And another point that I'm extremely proud of is that the Keller University participants saved 67 lives by donating blood at the Carter Blood Mobile that we had on site all 3 days. Some quotes from our teachers on social media, just to leave you with another just positive thought of our event. People saying that they felt blessed. They get to choose their PD based on their needs and interest. Somebody else had mentioned that they are feeling inspired and positive, encouraged, motivated, connected, new ideas, new strategies, and they're excited for a new school year. And lastly, I wanted to end with another teacher saying how amazing experience they had, wonderful keynotes, great classes. I think the most important part is they said they're fired up and they want to go out and change the world. So I'm very proud of Keller University this year, and I thank you for your time.
Thank you, Jennifer. Any questions or comments?
I have one.
Yes.
I know that it was everybody I've talked to has said how great it was and everything, and Ron Clark, I got there when he was the last of the picture taking, and I was took him back to his hotel.
Thank you very much for that.
He spoke about how everybody really treated him. You know, he said, y'all have a very unique place here. It's very, you know, people are outgoing. They're, you know, they have a mission, is what he said. And so, you know, I appreciate that went that way. Did they get credit for the Ron Clark for his, when he spoke?
Yes.
Or did they, because some of them were confused. They said, we didn't know if we got the hours.
Yes, that's a great question. When we put our speakers out, we were extremely excited about having them come. We had no idea how many would be in attendance. Putting it in perspective, last year, the most we had at a keynote was about 250 people. So when 1,100 people signed up to take Ron Clark, and we're at a Timber Creek Fine Arts facility that only holds about 793 people, actually 793, I know that number, we had to kind of revamp our process of what we should do. And one of those things was, instead of having people come an hour before to sign in, we actually had wristbands, like at a concert. So they got to pick up a wristband. If they picked their wristband up, they're getting credit for those classes. That tells us that they were there, they had their wristband on, they weren't able to get in into the facility without that wristband.
Okay.
Yes.
So how did you know, when they signed in, they gave
Yes, so they signed up for the course, and then they had to go pick up a wristband.
Okay, because I saw all of them had their wristband, but they said, one of them said, I don't think we're getting credit for that.
Yes, so an email is going out through our SCED, which is a online, basically the catalog, and that had all the information. An email is going out to them saying, yes, you're getting credit for all of them. They got 2.5 hours, actually, of credit for each keynote they went to.
I'll let them know.
Yes.
Thanks.
Thank you.
I just want to say, I think this is amazing that you offer this. Chris and I just found out today that we could have attended, so I'm really bummed because I was watching everything on Twitter and all the posts, and every teacher I've talked to has just been ecstatic that they were offered this opportunity for a couple of days to take care of things so that they're not missing time in the classroom. So
wonderful.
Thank you for you and your team for all your hard work.
Thank you, and I promise next year you all get a personal invitation from me. Okay.
Although it was quite entertaining to watch through the tweets.
Yes, it was fun. Except for when you're the in charge of it, you have to like everything.
You're right.
Like, oh my gosh, it's 2 a.m. I'm liking tweets. Yes, it was.
Yeah. No, I think it's just amazing that that teachers get to pick, you know, instead of having going to professional development, because a lot of times it's just a beat down. You know, and it is, and so great to, it was just so great to see all the energy and all the excitement, and I want to change the world. It's like, what teacher says that in the summer?
I know.
I mean,
it's exciting.
You know, so it's very exciting, and I think the timing of it is perfect, because they don't have to come back to school right away. You know, now they can talk to their friends and energize, so I appreciate it. I think you guys did a great, you're going to have a hard time topping it.
I'm a little
you know,
worried about that.
Like, who's going to come next year?
Dr. Westphal?
Santa Claus.
2 hours with you.
Well, maybe. So, all right. Thank you, Jennifer. Appreciate it. All right. Our last report is our district improvement plan. Miss Leah.
Hello.
Hello.
I'm going to close the show tonight.
She can hear you.
We know.
It's not go there yet.
She's ignoring us very well.
Good evening. Happy end of 17-18. So while the last day of school was several weeks ago, with our report this evening, we will officially close. Well, this is the next to last report. This is the DIP report, and in August, Jennifer Price will be here to share our STAR results with you. So I get to share everything, and she's gonna go in depth on our student performance on the state assessments in August. So you have these two pieces. Tonight, I'm gonna share with you the year-end report on those objectives that you approved for our 17-18 school year. For reference, you have a copy of those performance objectives and the action steps there on at your seat. Just an overall picture for you, as I've done in the past. You approved 13 performance objectives for us, and out of those, we identified over 80 action steps and strategies that were necessary to achieve these, to work towards these objectives. This chart represents our overall progress on those. Thus far, and through the hard work of many other people, I get to be the one that stands up here and shares that with you, that we are accomplished, on target, or above target with all of those action steps. It's through these action steps that we have been able to do many of the great things you've already heard about tonight. Keller University, the community building and the partnerships that went in there, and the great teacher learning and professional development. The modeling of instructional methods and best practices with our teachers that were provided through our CNI team. Building community and collaboration with our parents and students and staff through the visioning process. So all of that is a result of the work that y'all approved for us back in the fall. I'm gonna go through each one just briefly. I've added a few pictures this time, so you're not gonna just stare at pie charts the whole entire time. And maybe it'll give you a little glimpse into what happened of the year that was. For our number one priority, focusing on increasing our students' achievement, we focused this year on three performance objectives in reading, writing, and math. We had identified almost 40 strategies in those, and they've accomplished 30 and are on or above target the remainder of those. As mentioned before, Jennifer Price is going to provide a detailed report for you and in August on our STAR results, but we wanted to give you a preview, a very high-level overview of this, since it is related to our performance objectives. Two of our DIP goals address the student growth on STAR in math and reading. In math, we experienced a decline in student growth, while we saw an increase in reading growth. Our teams are currently reviewing the data that we've received to determine appropriate goals and targets for the 18-19 school year. This past year, we did implement Lucy Calkins' units of study to enhance our writing curriculum, beginning in kindergarten and going through grade four. As our implementation continues, we anticipate student performance to increase in that area as well. Some of the highlights of this year, so I just kind of went into our Twitter feed and started pulling things that gained a lot of traction and I thought captured the spirit of some of the action steps and strategies that we'd set into our plans. So some of the highlights this year included providing model lessons in our curriculum documents. We also provided live coaching and modeling of real time. Our coaches would go into classrooms and model that for teachers. Our librarians had a fantastic summer with their bus of books and was really well received by the community, and the kids were very excited for that. The expansion of Letterland to our additional campuses. Cap Rock was our big winner with Letterland Day. They had a great turnout from their community to participate in that day. And just our overall excitement with teachers sharing things on Twitter with their hashtags for math and ELA. We saw a lot of people getting involved and sharing and collaborating using social media. As they look to next year, our education support team, like I mentioned, is currently reviewing the data. And they're also working within their newly designed structure, our restructure, to provide support for our feeder patterns as they identify what their priorities and their goals are going to be for next year. So kind of building those different relationships within our feeder structures. Priority two is building community partnerships, excellence in our student and parent relationships. We continue to prioritize this. After your approval of the core values in May, the administration has already begun laying the foundation to bring those values to life with our staff for 18-19. The entire general administrator group, including all the campus principals and departmental leaders, spent last Monday diving deeply into the core values in preparation to develop their goals and their action plans for next year. So stay tuned next fall for updates on the progress towards that. We're also looking forward to launching a revamped approach to our survey work. So we'll continue with two of those surveys as we've traditionally done, our employee exit interview or survey and our new hire survey after they come on board. But we're revamping that to launch an employee engagement survey annually, our technology survey annually, and then more of an organizational survey, which will give campuses more input into the questions that are going out and customize it towards their campus community. As we heard really clearly, the principals are the face of the district to their parents and obviously to their staff as well. We always have timely topic feedback loops through social media and our 24/7 feedback accessibility. But we're also looking at DEIC and our FACT committees to engage in that feedback. And finally, for this particular one, as you're well aware, our communications team coordinated a social media campaign to increase public awareness of how Keller ISD is financed and how we operate within the parameters of our fiscal constraints. And with the benefit of Twitter analytics, they saw interactions with their communications pieces go well beyond their targets. So impressions are kind of like how many times somebody has seen this or it's crossed their feed. So they had a goal of 300,000. That sounds massive, right? They had over 570,000 impressions. So it was well beyond the audience that they anticipated reaching. They also surpassed their goals with Keller 101 video views as well. So all of that feeding into just trying to get the message out there about how we work. For excellence in processes and systems, you had 12 action steps here that we have accomplished, and there's actually four different performance objectives within this one. You can kind of see them bulleted out there. Over the course of this year, our technology team has focused on simplifying access to resources and information for our staff. That's kind of been the main focus driving any of the projects that they're working on. And they coordinated with several different groups to launch an internal administrative matrix for use with our campus leaders to help communicate things to them. An even bigger project this summer, while in the midst of KU and everything else,
has been the retirement of our intranet platform, K-Connect. We can all say thank you, K-Connect, for your 10 years of service to Keller ISD. We are replacing you now.
Done with you.
Yeah, it's time to go. So it's being replaced by K-Cloud, an application portal that's kind of like a one-stop shop. Everybody goes directly here to get access to your information, and you click this, and it takes you to the right place. That rolled out at KU last week, and they're currently making that transition in time for teachers to return in August. This transition was in large part due to your approval of the funds to allow for an updated electronic security framework too. So we were able to make some of those changes happen very quickly. As I shared in April, the implementation of the new work order management system continues to go well. They had completed that back then, but you can see from the tweets that our custodians and our maintenance and operations staff get a lot of love on Twitter and appreciation for the things that they do. Anywhere from helping assessment to move furniture to getting ready for our KEEP program with our early childhood director, and then also just hanging banners. These are the daily things that they're working on. But this new system is gonna allow Hudson and his team to better track those requests and allocate the resources appropriately. And as more data is accumulated, Hudson can forecast into high need times and allocate those resources even better. And finally, related to Amanda's two-year target, so we had one that was carrying over into next year, an effort to update and move our administrative regulations.
Everybody loves ARs.
She's launched a survey for department and campus input on those ARs and has a teacher and two campus teams doing an in-depth review. Like, they volunteered. They wanted to help. They did.
Easy people.
They're going to give her feedback on those, detailed feedback, and then she'll analyze that over into next year and use that feedback to execute the revisions before launching them into a new platform. We didn't want to carry anything over, just copy paste into a new system. We wanted it to be real.
Mm-hmm. Clean it up.
Recognizing the continued importance of wellness culture within our Keller ISD, this requires our commitment as well as the campuses being committed. And as you heard earlier, our workforce team has really focused over the year on their educational campaign to help employees learn how they can have more ownership of their healthcare. They've provided over 80 sessions to help employees learn how to access and take advantage of some of the healthcare tools that we have, such as the health cost estimator tool. We've talked to them about what it means to be self-funded, all of the conversations in the spring added into that, and just raising awareness about how you can actually select healthcare facilities, and you have some options within that. We feel really strongly that the training was successful due to an incredible 28% increase in employees accessing the healthcare cost estimator tool. As compared to 16-17, there's a 28% increase in usage. Another indicator that the training sessions were effective is evident in our employee ER visits. And they'd set a goal to reduce those by 3.5% as compared to last year, and they far exceeded that and dropped that by 11%.
Awesome.
Just for comparison, we are 24% below our public school peers in that department. So just letting you know that this is an ER. This is a, you
this
know.
This is urgent care.
Yes. And last but not least, the finance team worked diligently this year, as did every other function alongside of them, to condense what is usually a 12-month cycle into 10 months. Your adoption of the budget in June was the final step in this historic transition. And as we look towards next year, our goals related to this district priority will be impacted by the results in September. But the commitment to excellence in financial stewardship will continue as always. So what to look forward to, next steps for 18-19. We're currently finalizing the comprehensive needs assessment, beginning to draft performance objectives and look at what the needs are across feeder patterns. You can look forward to seeing those in October when they'll be presented to you as usual. And at this time, we are all happy. Well, everybody behind me.
We are all happy to answer any questions you might have about our year.
Okay, do we have any questions for Ms. Beard? No? Okay, well, I have something to say. And I promise that I'm not going to cry, even though I'm taking pain medicine. we are going to miss you. You have done so much for this district and just for me personally. But I know that what you're doing is right, and that that we grow good people, and so good people go, and they spread their wings, and so. Just want to thank you just for even making something like this tolerable and learning and making us see that that it really is important, that it matters. It's not just something else that we're making teachers do or something else that people are doing just to say that we're doing it, but that it actually matters, and there's actually outcomes and changes because of it. So good luck. And we'll see you in October. Just kidding.
Yeah. I can hang out in the back.
Okay. No. We'll call and ask if they give you a reprieve. But we'll miss you, but we know that God's putting you exactly where you need to be.
I appreciate every opportunity that I've had. I appreciate y'all asking questions about this and being interested in it. I think I was born with the idea that we can do it better. What can we do better? So I do appreciate the space to you apply that passion. So
okay,
thank y'all.
Thank you, Leah. All right. The next item on our agenda are the work session discussion, scheduling events.
Yeah, I just got to make sure everybody has all of the fun calendar events coming up. New Teacher Week, believe it or not, is starting up. Week after next, August 1st through the 3rd. Keller ISD, now remember, we just adopted a resolution. Amanda was talking about the 12 former students who have been working on TACs. We actually we're making sure they're part of our summer school graduation program. So August the 9th is our summer graduation, along with those TACs test exemption former students at 6 o'clock right here in the Rock Gym. August 10th is convocation. We've been doing a little videoing for that here and there, you know, for feeder patterns and stuff. So convocation, 9:30 and 1. If you haven't already, if you can just let Galen know if you can or cannot attend, and that way we can make sure we're making the appropriate, or if it's Shelley, just let someone know so that we can anticipate your attendance. August 15th is the first day of school. And in front of you is the roll-up of trustee assignments to campuses. So Galen put these together for you guys so that you would have these. And as always, if there is a particular campus that you are going to inevitably trade with another trustee, just let Galen know, please. It has to be a one-for-one, and Galen has to be aware, so that's the only thing we ask.
Trading has begun.
I figured as soon as you saw it, I saw the pen start to write. I saw that. And then our next regular board meeting is on August the 27th.
Okay.
That's all I've got.
All right. Any questions about any of the scheduling? If you'll let them know about convocation and anything else. I also wanted to remind you that did everybody get their EISO training at TASA-TASB this summer?
Yes.
So I'm the only one that needs to do that? Okay. Well, I'm going to do it on August the 6th, so I will not be publicly humiliated by the state legislature for whatever.
There's going to be a flogging.
I've signed up, and I'm ready to go. I promise I will attend. And so do I have a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
Second. All right. Second. Okay. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. It is 8:20.
Woohoo!